praise the Lord. I want to start off this morning and with the book of Ephesians. And I think the eighth verse is fine, Ephesians 4 and 8. And you have it, say, I have it. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now this, he ascended. What does it mean but that he also first descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. Just hold that thought, and let's look at the book of Acts and the 12th verse, Acts 4 and 12. Just one verse there. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. That's pretty impressive, isn't it? It's only one name. You don't have to figure out a lot of them, just one. This time of my sharing, the Lord wants to convey simple solutions to his people. And I feel this is probably the most simple of words, and yet they will carry you to Jesus. And that's a pretty good journey, isn't it? God has always provided a way of escape for his people. Always has. There's not a time that's in recorded history that he did not prepare a way for his people. Even in the New Covenant, it says he also, with temptation, will make a way of escape. So he's always allowed an escape, prepared for his people, made a way for his people. When the children of Israel were coming out of Egypt, just prior to them leaving, God gave a way of escape. He said that you're to paint the doorposts with the blood of a lamb, and when I see the blood, I'm going to pass over you. Even though there was havoc wreaked in Egypt and death was all around them, death did not come to God's people because God had made a way for them. And yet I know there are times that God delivers people, his people, from death and also delivers his people through death. And with that being said, the word of the Lord to all of us, at least it first came to me, I was just kind of going through this through my dreams. And while in my dreams, the Lord was just speaking to me. And it was a very simple word. He said, just no other solution. Just no other solution. And, you know, he said it over and over again. And this was a rarity because I woke up one time. And then, you know, sometimes when a dream is real good and you wake up and you want to recapture it, that somebody wakes you up at the wrong time because you were just right there. Because I remember when I was a little boy, sometimes I would dream about flying and my mama would wake me up. And then I'll try to snooze back again. I never could get that flight again. Well, this was not the case because after I woke up and went back to sleep, the Lord once again began to deal with my heart about no other solution. I understood that's a word that he wanted to convey to you. And when there's no other solution, guess what that means? That means there are no other solutions. And the thing that makes you to be a peculiar people, the thing that makes you to be a holy nation, the thing that makes you to be a separate people unto the Lord, is that we are the people who call on the name of the Lord as our solution. And while there are many things that God has done through the earth, through men and women for the ages, yet we know it's the provider, the Lord Jesus Christ, who's given us everything. And so it is as the Lord navigates his church through turbulent days, as he's done in the past, that our confidence is that we have no other solution than the name of the Lord, and we don't have to run around and try to find out what are we going to do? What are we going to do? What we're going to do is call on the name of the Lord is what we're going to do. It's what the fathers of old, is what the children of Israel did. They called on the name of the Lord, and they were made safe. I want you to go to 2 Samuel, if you would. 2 Samuel chapter 22. 2 Samuel 22. And this is something that you can go back home and read this also, and I won't read through the whole thing, because when he started writing this song, it was powerful. It was a powerful song. It says, "Then David spoke to the Lord the words of this song on the day when the Lord had delivered him from the hand of all his enemies and from the hand of Saul." Let me just pause, go back to that. Now, the hand of Saul, Saul dogged David's life. And there are a lot of things David could overcome, but that Saul just wouldn't seem to get out of his way. And whether he was in caves and the whole army of a great nation were hunting him down, seeking to destroy him. And it's through those times that he began to know what it meant to call on the name of the Lord. And so now this is the aftermath that David spoke the words of this song, and he spoke him to God. Next verse. And he said, "Lord, the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer." How do you feel about that? Let's just repeat it. Go back, if you wouldn't. Just give me that backing in. Let's do that together. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. Again, the Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. Last time, the Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. The Lord is my deliverer. The Lord is my deliverer. He's my rock. He's my fortress. Fortress, he protects me. My rock, I'm anchored. And my deliverer, I'm saved. Next verse. The God of my strength, in whom I will trust, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold and my refuge, my Savior, you saved me from violence. I will call upon the name of the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. When the waves of death surrounded me and the floods of ungodliness made me afraid, the sorrows of Sheol, or hell, surrounded me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called upon the name of the Lord. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried out to my God. He heard my voice, and from his temple, and my cry entered into his ears. Then the earth shook. Here's the aftermath. The people of God called on the name of the Lord, and then the earth shook and trembled. The foundations of heaven quaked and were shaken because he was angry. Angry at who? Angry at those who opposed God's people. Smoke went up from his nostrils and devouring fire from his mouth. Coals were kindled by it. He bowed the heavens also and came down with darkness under his feet. He rode upon a cherub and flew, and he was seen upon the wings of the wind. He made darkness canopies around him, dark waters and thick clouds of the skies. From the brightness before him, coals of fire were kindled. The Lord thundered from heaven, and the Most High uttered his voice. And he sent out arrows and scattered them, lightning bolts, and he vanquished them. Then the channels of the sea were seen. The foundations of the world were uncovered at the rebuke of the Lord, at the blast of the breath of his nostrils. this is something worthy to read all of it. But the simple message that the Lord wants us to know, and I reiterate this, because you are separate people unto him, because he has declared you to be and made you to be holy, and you walk in the holiness that you've been made to be. It doesn't mean that you're not in a war. It doesn't mean that we're not surrounded by opposing forces and lying spirits and fallen devils. It just means that the same God that was mentioned in praise and worship is the same God who this scripture says, I'm coming to see about you. That you can't go through anything that I won't come to you. That's what Jesus said. Behold, I will come to you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. And so again, there's never a time when God, when you call upon the name of the Lord, that he won't come to you. This is the privilege of knowing the real Jesus who made everything. And God has invested into the name of the Lord every solution that we would ever need for any opportunity or challenge or any thought that we need a decision about. Step by step, the Lord will reveal his heart to his people. And the times don't change God. God changes the times. And when you're wondering what is going to be the solutions for the problems that are in the world, the only solution provided by God that will ever exist is the person and the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, so that you don't have to be wondering what is the next best thing that we should find out. We've already discovered who he is and what he's going to do, and his promise is safe with you. This is the reason that he gives us exceeding great and precious promises, so that by these we will be partakers of his nature, having escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust. And so the Lord will have you to know that there is no new solution. That the same solution that opened every door for the believers of the past is the same solution that opens the doors for us now. When I was a little boy, I've told you this story before, but it merits telling you again so you can get the essence and the heart of what God is saying. I used to play from Broad Street, and I would go through the woods and go over to my mom and dad's house. And down in Virginia, they have a lot of snakes, moccasins and black snakes and creepy crawlers. And there was a small path through this wooded area. And so I would take my daddy's flashlight, and as I went through the woods, I would never shine the light in front of me. And I didn't hold it up over my head. The danger was at my feet. And so I kept the light at my feet. And the Bible says the Lord will be a lamp unto your feet and a light unto your path. And the beauty of this is that God may not show you next week or next month, but he will always show you the next step. And in showing you and revealing you to you the next step, what you need to do, what you need to buy, what you don't need to buy, what you need to sell, when you need to sell. In other words, God would like to be personally involved in every decision that you take, nothing casual, that even when you're in the department store want to buy a dress or a jacket, call on the name of the Lord so that you won't say, oh, I bought that. That is one ugly thing that I bought. Why did I buy that? Because we just involve the Lord in every aspect. That's the privilege of the children of God. What grandchild or child can't come to you and ask questions that you do not pause and want to know exactly what their request is or what's on their heart? That you listen to them and then you give them a response in wisdom or a response that simply says no. But God always, when he says no, always has a better yes. That he will not allow us to falter with a mediocre answer when he has the best plan for us. Jeremiah 29 said, I know my plans for you, my thoughts towards you that are good and not evil, a plan to give you hope. And the word hope there is the word tikva. Say tikva. tikva. It actually means a rope. And it's the same word used when Rahab the harlot, which you know what her occupation was, that she let down a rope. The children of Israel told her, said, "We're coming into the land." And she was one of the foreigners. And they said, "When you come in, when you come into Jericho, I want you to just let down a rope to indicate that we're going to keep that house safe." That word rope is tikva. In other words, show us your hope in the Lord, living God. And we are to do the same thing. God has hope, which is defined as an expectation for good. Anytime there's no hope, depression. The door is open for depression or oppression. But where there is hope, you'll never be made ashamed. So God has hope for his people, and God has the solution for his people that brings hope. So lest we forget, lest we report more about the shenanigans of people who are blind and why they cannot see, let us overwhelmingly, on our day-to-day efforts in life, call on the name of the Lord, who will provide for you always an escape, always a solution, always a way out, because he is personal. You cannot ask him for wisdom and he not give it. Matter of fact, he said, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives it freely and will not hold it back. He won't scold you for asking. If you want to know the mind of God, he's going to confirm direction with peace. That his directions will never conflict with the word of the Lord. You won't hear God say one thing and then tell you you read something different in the Bible. That's how you know that when the word comes to your heart, it will line up with the principles in the scripture, because the Lord is navigating his people through these turbulent waters just like he did before. Remember again, when the children of Israel came out of Egypt, God had a plan to rescue them. And when the waters were in front of them and the armies were behind him, then they called on the name of the Lord. And when they called on the name of the Lord, Moses was talking to God, and God said, "Listen, stretch forth your staff. Don't cry unto me. Move forward." And so he did. And guess what? The waters opened, because God had a plan. He would never allow his people to be hinged in, that they will be pressed in by the enemy without a way of escape. So God is the one that opened the seas. And so when there was no rain, Elijah called down rain, and he stopped it first. And then 3.5 years later, it started again. Even though visually you couldn't see that it was going to rain, because it's just a small cloud. But we don't walk by sight. We walk by faith. And walking by faith means we walk by what God says, even when it doesn't feel like it's right. I had one of the brothers to define for me what a rut was. A rut. Anybody ever heard of a rut? Anybody ever said that I've been in a rut? Well, from an agricultural standpoint, being in a rut is where it has rained and maybe a tractor tire has pressed the soil down and compressed it and compacted it, and it kind of creates a small ravine. And that's how it is with the life of a believer if they find themselves in a rut. And in a rut, sometimes you begin to think thoughts and you combine some facts, and all of a sudden you create a narrative in your mind, but it begins to make you feel bad or make you feel like, maybe how am I going to get out of this? And the whole time you're just in a rut. That's not God speaking, that's your enemy speaking. The soil is compacted in a rut, as I said, and if you were to put corn in a rut, it would probably be about that tall when everything else on good ground is real tall, because the roots cannot flourish and the crop cannot grow properly. And you cannot grow in a rut. And your roots cannot expand in a rut. And so David said, "I called on the Lord, the name of the Lord, in my distress. And the Lord heard me and pulled me out of the rut." Remember last Sunday, I talked to you about another gospel, and Paul was addressing Galatians and the Corinth church, and he said to Galatians, he said, "I'm so shocked that you're so removed, so quickly removed from this gospel unto another gospel, which really isn't, but some people are troubling you. In other words, if I would put it this way, I'm shocked that you're looking for another solution. And the Lord delights when you call upon him for every solution, for every opportunity, or if it is a problem. In other words, God has solution for relationships. God has solution for children. God has solution for jobs. God has solutions for the wisdom of buying, selling, possessing, what to do, what not to do, that you may have the peace of God in your decisions and you can walk in the flow of the great gift called the love of God. Because love, as I mentioned last week, never fails. And Jesus is the solution that brings us the love of God. Remember, I told you that the greatest freedom for believers to be able to walk anywhere with the capacity to love anybody. Even though the person that you're loving may not be trustworthy, the Lord didn't say trust them, did he? But he did say love them. Love them is not based on their action. Love is based on your constitution. It's based on who you are. You cannot get God not to be love. Because God is love. And so therefore he can issue the command, as I said, love your enemy, even your enemy. Why? Because he doesn't want you to become like your enemy. He doesn't want you to talk like your enemy. He wants you to talk like him. He wants you to say that all things are possible to them that believe, because that's the word of the Lord. Great is the Lord that we serve, lest you think that your enemies that are maybe in your mind are giants and you are but a grasshopper. But the truth of the matter is the Lord that you serve is the one that's great and grand. So we magnify the Lord and we minimize the problem of the situation. So in the days, as the days unfold, and this is important and a notable word to hear, how God began things and how God's going to wrap things up. That's important. And that, because I heard it in the worship. I heard in prayer that he's the same God. He's the same God. I said, well, why don't you just preach my message then? Because God wants you to know that, lest you're pushed off balance by the actions of people. That you find yourself, I don't understand, by the actions of people, and being pushed off course from your faith. But your faith stands sure in spite of the actions of people. You would never indict a blind man for walking into a pole. Why? Because he can't see. We got a text from a loved one, and they were in a restaurant, and in the text, the loved one said, I was sitting there eating, and all of a sudden, I felt this tapping, just tapping on my leg. And so she thought it was just a mistake and said, just tap, 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 tap. And so she was getting a little irritated, so she was going to turn around and said, what are you doing? Until the last tap, and she looked down and saw that little red tip. Now, what does that mean? The one that was tapping was blind, trying to find where the chairs were, and her leg was there. And so there's a great revelation in that somebody who's blind is always tapping, tapping, tapping to try to find out where to go. And so if they tap you, just show them the way. God has set us in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, and he's made us a peculiar people, so that we will not be tainted at all, but we will be vehemently, I mean with overwhelming joy, focused on the word of the Lord. And so in this dialogue, and I told you about my dream, God kept speaking to me, only solution, only solution. And you know, sometimes when God speaks, it takes me a minute to kind of catch up to what he's saying. And it couldn't be complicated, it couldn't be deep, except I just didn't know initially. But the more it unfolded, and I would wake up, and then I said, I went back, and I got the same dream again. So I knew that was the Lord. And what's the word to you? No other solution. That your way to victory is fixed. is secure and is solid. There may be some naysayers that may tell you, or whispers that may say, it doesn't work because I asked God and this hasn't happened yet. From the broad standpoint, that we understand that while we may say this hasn't happened, there's a million things that have happened for your behalf, not to mention every cell in your body that's working. So we don't want to ever be found like the world indicting God for one thing without celebrating him for a million things. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers them from them all. How many can you say all? And so I knew that when we came together today, that this word would be something for you, or given to from the Lord's heart to you, that you can hold on to. Because it's a fact, challenges are going to happen. And it will be the wrong gospel to tell you that you may not face some challenges. It's just that they will not overwhelm you if in the moment you practice calling on the name of the Lord. Finding out, God, what do you say about this? Before you go on a tangent and thinking out and creating a whole movie, just pause and say, Lord, what do you want to do with this? What do you want to do with this? I'm here to serve you. How do you want to handle that? Did you hear what they said, Lord, about you? Even though they were talking about you personally, you turned it and said, Lord, listen what they're saying about you. Why? Because you belong to him. And so as a result of that, church, if we're to get anything today, and especially from that great psalm, that it'll come to your remembrance as the days unfold, that as for me and my house, we shall call upon the name of the Lord. Now here's where it gets critical. What did that look like? It looks like a mother or father lifting their voice in their house and declaring the name of the Lord over everything that you call important. What it looks like is for every grandfather and every grandmother in their home to lift up their voice and declare the name of the Lord against every opponent, every enemy, every lie, everything revealed to you that's not appropriate and that is not right. For the Bible says, I will give you the keys of the kingdom. And so whatever you bind on earth, I'm going to back you up from heaven. I know that's an amplified version, but it's true. I'm going to back you up. When your declarations match the heart of God, I'm going to back up what you say. And if you ask for mercy for somebody else, I'm going to give mercy because of what you say. And for those who are out of the way and may be blind, I'm going to call on the name of the Lord for the blind, and the blind will see. Amen. Now, what I am telling you is that there is, in our generation, faith that is gravitating to other gospels, other messages, other solutions, and you see it every day. But what we know, that some trust in horses, others trust in chariots, but what are we going to do? We're going to trust in the name of the Lord. Could you be kind enough and give me Psalms 27 real quick? Just pull that up real quick for me. And this is our safety. This is our security. There's probably not a parent that I know of that doesn't have some concern about, what about my child's future? What about my baby's future? And the answer to that is that there's no different solutions, because the same one that's kept his people all through time is the same one that's going to keep your family that you love. Oh, clap your hands, all you people. Shout to God with a voice of triumph. For the Lord Most High is awesome. For the Lord Most High is, he's awesome. For the Lord Most High is awesome. He is a great king over all the earth. How much of the earth? All the earth. I got to tell you that this is not going to change. His character, his attributes, that's not going to change. It's never going to change no matter what happens around God's people. He doesn't change towards God's people. He will subdue the peoples under us and the nations under our feet. He will choose our inheritance for us, the excellence of Jacob, whom he loves, Selah. Speaking about the descendancy of the children of Jacob and who extended from Abraham, by the way, and which we are the sons and daughters of Abraham also. I love this last one right here. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. And what that really is victory. It's really speaking to the resurrection of Jesus, that the Lord went up with a shout, with the sound of a trumpet. You'll go into another Psalms when they said, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. The angel's response said, who is the King of glory? He said, the Lord strong and mighty, and the Lord mighty in battle. Take nothing for granted. And I'm about to wrap this up because it's so important that just this word for you is necessary for your heart so that you will not fall in despair, that you won't create a movie where it's no truth. Even though you got actors in it, it's just not true. But what is true is the name of the Lord and the declarations of God for his people. And so when we look at the fact that God is your victory, that he is your strength, that God has provided solutions for every situation, there's nothing that cannot be fixed through the name of Jesus. So say this with me, and there's nothing broke that can't be fixed. There's nothing broke that can't be fixed. There's nothing broke. So the Bible says they that know that their God shall be strong and shall do exploits because our confidence is in the Lord. And it doesn't mean that you don't do your due diligence and do things in life. I'm not talking about resting back and doing nothing. I'm simply saying you're being proactive in what God will lead you to do. But at the same time, we know behind our efforts is the solution maker and the solution giver, the one who empowers us all to do the will of God and the work of the Lord, that we may be a voice to somebody else, that we may speak life where there's just like pending death, that we can bring correction and lift up a soul because we are confident in the Lord that we serve. How many understand what I'm saying? Now, you notice I closed this? You know what that means? How about if I carry it? Does that mean anything to you? It's the whispers of life that get God's people down. It is. It's just the whispers. And I'm not saying it's got to apply to anybody every day, but occasionally Satan's going to use the same tactic that he always uses. He's going to say. That's what he did to Jesus. And the devil came to him and he said, if you be the Son of God, let me just get you to doubt who you are. If you be the child of God, then make these stones bread with your hungry self. So he's taking a factual situation. Jesus was hungry because the Bible says after fasting 40 days, and I know you've been fasting about 40 minutes, but after 40 days, afterward, he was hungry. He ought to be hungry after 40 days. And, you know, you ought to be hungry after 40 minutes, too. How about that? Call you and you say, Pastor, I'm really going through. You already changed your voice. What's wrong? I'm really going through. This actually happened to me. And it was a brother. I said, what's wrong? I'm consecrating unto the Lord. I said, ooh, for 40 minutes. And so, well, we don't need to distort our figure. We don't need to act like we're going through this immense suffering. We're to wash our face, square our shoulders. Not if you fast, it's when you fast. And why is that important? When you fast, this, you got to hear this. This will blow you away. Because fasting humbles the soul. It puts in check the human desire that God may come alive in your spirit. Now, there's no fast police, which said it's not 40 minutes, it's not an hour and a half. It's exactly whatever you want it to be between you and God. But it is a very important spiritual discipline. If you master food, you can master anything. Because it's by the way of food that the whole world fell, right? She saw the food that it was good to eat. And you're saying, Pastor, move on. just get past that. COVID is out here. What does that got to do with fasting and praying? When you know that God is your solution. But are you ready for this? In the battle of being a believer, you can get some hits. And so the scripture says, I got you covered. See, God's going to come to you. He said, confess your sin, and he is just and faithful to forgive you. How about forgiveness? Everybody love that? But do you not know there's another component to that makes this work? It is beautiful to be forgiven. Forgiveness is from God, and it's instantaneous from those who call on the name of the Lord. It's instantaneous. God will forgive his people. Aren't you glad? He won't drop them. He won't leave them. He will forgive his people. And if he wants you to forgive people seven times, and you're human in one day, then I'm just simply saying from your heart, if you're asking forgiveness from your heart, God is going to give you that. But he didn't stop with forgiveness. And this is where it gets important about calling on the name of the Lord. Not only will he forgive you, but the next part of that scripture says he will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. I want to tell you they're not the same. Forgiveness and cleansing is not the same. You say, Pastor, what are you saying? I am saying, since you ask, forgiveness and cleansing are not the same. Because if you're forgiven, you could go back. In other words, I asked God to forgive me from that, and he did, and I found myself back in that same spot 2 weeks later. But the Lord forgave me, so I needed to ask the Lord to forgive me again. And guess what? He'll forgive you again. But then another 2 weeks passed, and I found myself in the same spot 2 weeks later. And what is going on? I asked God to forgive me because there is another component called cleanse. And cleansing, forgiveness is divine, but cleansing, you become a participant to cleansing. You know, it's like, and this is a gross example, but you can handle it. It's like you're going to have some people over for dinner, and you're just up there playing with your grandbaby, and the little pamper was a little loose around the legs, you know? Everybody got the picture? Yeah, it's gross. But it was kind of loose around the legs. And so there you're just playing, and all of a sudden some of things fell on the table. Just a little bit, though. Just a little bit. And so you tell your son, who is 13, that means his brain is not developed. What the real life saints say so. Not at 18 either. But anyway, and you said, boy, clean that table off. he comes through and he just takes a dry towel and just wipes it. So now your company comes over and you pass your famous macaroni and cheese. And all of a sudden the company says, maybe she used a special kind of cheese. But this is a little different. Just because the young kid that you had at 13 just wiped it off. See, God not just going to wipe it off. He's going to apply something to cleanse it. And whether you got to spray some disinfectant on that, you got to put some Lysol or some thieves on that. And if it doesn't want to move, use a Brillo pad, but God is committed to cleansing. And if forgiveness has to happen 3 or 4 or 5 times for the same thing, maybe the cleansing requires a Brillo pad. Because sometimes baked on goods, you got to use a little bit more elbow grease to get it, but you're committed to getting it clean. Anybody who's ever baked in a pan, you know that you bake and you get that baked on residue, you got to kind of scrub it. And aren't you glad that your God is committed to you, to scrubbing you? But the scrubbing is a process. And in that process, you will no longer want the appetite. The residue is the appetite. The cleansing from all ungodliness is removing the appetite for the thing that you had to constantly be forgiven for. So that you no longer want to be forgiven for that, because I got a mastery over this now and I don't want to go through this anymore. God's forgiven me and he's cleansed me. I don't want it no more. I don't want that anymore. You can't entice me with that anymore. And that's the process of forgiveness and cleansing, and that's a father. And he's not going to just wipe it. He said, Lord, does it take all that? And then this easy peasy casual generation, we just think, okay, God, forgive me. Pop. No. He's going to get down to business, to your appetite. He'll correct the appetite so you don't desire the thing. When the preacher is preaching good, when did the house say amen? You see a thing about that Brillo pad. That's what that is. But a loving God is for you. He's the solution. He knows the solution. And where there is no appetite for something, you don't do it. There's a boldness with being able to say freely, I don't want to. Not because I'm afraid to go to hell. I don't want to. I don't want to. And then you grow in your faith with a boldness that says, no, I will never insult the name of the Lord because he's delivered me. I will not return because I've been delivered. And freedom feels better than bondage. Am I right? So who the Son has set free is free indeed. So if you're free, then be free. Just be free, calling on the name of the Lord, not as a religious exercise, but as a holy conversation that gets God's attention. It comes from the heart of God's people to him. And let me tell you, you can go through the valley, but he's with you. And there's a peace that goes beyond understanding because he's with you. That you're not like those who don't know God, but you possess a hope because you do. And that hope, you're retraining and renewing your mind with the hope that is in the Lord. How many understand what we're saying? Okay, so in conclusion, calling on the name of the Lord, just hold your wife's hand in the house, or you're single, hold your hand. See, there's always a way of escape. You got hands, hold them. So what are you doing? I'm holding hands. With who? Myself. I'm touching and agreeing with the living God. And I'm calling on the name of the Lord. And what does that look like? And what does that sound like? It sounds just like this. Oh, Lord, maker of heaven and the earth, provider of all things, and the keeper of my soul. Lord God, it is with great joy that I call on your name, for you have loved me with an everlasting love. You love my husband. You love my babies. You love my house. And I bless your name right now, always, tomorrow, and the days to follow. And I declare the name of the Lord over my kitchen, living room, bathroom, bedroom, hallway, my car, my yard, my grass. In the name of Jesus, I declare your name on my kidneys and on my heart, my lungs, my legs, my muscles, my toes, my feet, the hair that's in my ear. Be blessed by the name of the Lord, for you are great and greatly to be praised. You have made me and not myself. So I declare in the name of the Lord, I am your house and your temple. I am the place that can only praise your name, not the rocks. I will not allow it on my behalf. I will praise you from the rising of the sun to the setting of the same, because you are worthy to be praised. And in this house, the house of Ricks, the house of Mitchell, the house of Jones, the house of whoever soever will call on the name of the Lord, then it opens a channel between you and God. And someone would make a call to you and say, we heard about this. How are we going to work this thing out? What are you going to do? And you say, I'm going to call on the name of the Lord, and I'm going to declare his goodness on this matter. And the enemies will be overthrown, and God will make my way plain. He's taken the crooked path and straightened it out. And when there's waters, he opened them just for me. For the Lord loves me with an everlasting love that will never fail. And I will declare his name. And I will testify in the house of the Lord of his goodness. That's calling on the name of the Lord. That's calling on the name of the Lord. And the Spirit of God will give you unction and give you flow as you remember in your mind just how good God is. We got believers that are ill, that don't feel good. And what do I do about that? Guess what? I called on the name of the Lord early this morning. We got mothers and we got fathers that don't feel good, because in this human body, you can get a don't feel good moment. Am I right about it? I want you to take this the way I mean it. But there was a time when they didn't have hospitals. I wonder what they did. In their distress, they called on the name of the Lord. I'm not saying that thank God for the benefit of hospitals and physicians and all those things and the blessing of the Lord in that. But while I'm going to that blessing, I am still calling on the name of the Lord with all my heart, lest he thinks I forgot that he provides all things. There's a thanksgiving that comes from calling on the name of the Lord. It causes you to survey all God has given to you and look around and just be thankful for it. Just be thankful. Just be thankful that I just engulf my heart with thanksgiving and blessing. And it is not hard to thank God. You know, just that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Your eyeballs are working. Raise your hand if your eyeballs are working. Or you thought they were supposed to work. That you tell me how a ball that's consisted mostly of water, with all those minute components, can see. You can see this red jacket I'm wearing. But it's amazing that my eyeball is working. So I was on the telephone, and I was talking to somebody, and I was it was coming through my vehicle, and I said, listen, I got to pause. I just thought about another reason to praise God. Another reason to praise God. Another reason to offer him thanks. So imagine that taking a place around the whole world, that believers in every nation calling on the name of the Lord with thanksgiving and praise. And that's a symphony in the ears of the Lord. That's why he can always take care of his people. It doesn't mean that there are not challenges. It just means that God is going to make a way of escape for you. Amen? All right. So let this be your confidence. This week, you're probably going to need exactly what I'm saying before you respond, because I know God took the cusser out of you, so you don't. So you can't rely on that no more, because you'll be like. But he took it out, and so you want to use it, but it's gone, and you just be mouthing because the Lord took that out of your heart. You didn't want no part of it. Because you believe the scripture say, let no bad communication come out of your mouth. And so before you go to that lane as your defense, let God be your defense. Just calm down, check yourself, let God be your defense. Try not to say things that you'll be sorry for later. So ask God wisdom before you say it, especially to your spouse or, you know, maybe you'll go to heaven quicker than you thought. Yeah, spouses are real. Amen. How many understand what we're saying? How many understood that thing about forgiveness and cleansing? God wants to take away the appetite. It's the appetite. It's the appetite. He wants to remove that. Where there's no appetite, there's no chance, or well, not chance, but likelihood of you returning back. Amen. That's the loving God working with you. Stand with me now. All right, I want to bless you now and your families. Father, in the name of Jesus, everything that the people of God would call hard, every mounted opposition of Satan that is opposing the mind, the thoughts, the hearts, the posterity, the destiny, the high calling of your people, be overthrown, knocked down, cast down, interrupted. Make it come to nothing in the name of Jesus. That the power of your name will be declared from the mouth of your people. Lord God, secure the destiny and future of their children and their children's children. And even the babies that are yet in the loins of fathers that have not come forth yet, grandchildren and great-grandchildren, be sanctified and made holy because of who these parents are, because of who they are in you. Lord God, be merciful. Be merciful, Lord God. Open the heart. Bring forth floodgates of forgiveness. Lord God, a freedom to love and to walk in the potency of the love of God, being seated in heavenly places, in high places, in Christ Jesus, above the wiles of principalities, liars, devils, demons, strange spirits from old, to be revisited again and being driven back to their places and habitations, that at the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, declarations will be made from mothers and fathers and children concerning the power of the Lord, that men, young men, will walk holy, sanctified, godly lives and not give in to the gods of Baal, Astaroth, and the lies of demons and devils and pagans, that they will call on the name of the Lord because the Lord has called men, young men, because they are strong. Thank you, Lord God, that you have prepared your army for these last days and that you fortified us in our heart to know that our defense is in the name of the Lord and there is no other solution. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ.